Welcome to KU Band. Today we are going to discuss about mechanical features like types of enclosures, types of bearings, types of mountings, reduction of noise and transmission of drive. In second part, applications of motors like different motors for particular service. Let us go to selection of motors. What is the need of selection of motors? As we know, the selection of motors itself has become an important and tedious. The selection of motors depends primarily on the conditions under which it has to operate and type of load it has to handle. Before selection of motors, we have to learn few factors like electrical characteristics, mechanical characteristics, size and rating of motors and cost. In electrical characteristics, its starting characteristic, running characteristic, speed control and braking. In mechanical characteristic, mainly the motor structural features like types of enclosures, types of bearings, mountings, noise and transmission of power. Coming to size and rating of motor. In this case, the motor requirement for continuous load, intermittent load and variable load and its overload capacity. And coming to cost. In this case, the motor capital cost and its running cost. By considering all factors, we have to select the motors for particular purpose. In previous classes, we have seen about different motors' electrical characteristics. In this class, we shall discuss in details about mechanical characteristics. At a glance, you can see some motor different parts. Here you see the figure. This is a single phase motor and you can see a stator with enclosures, rotor and in covers, cooling system and its bearings and terminal box. Here is a terminal box, another is a capacitor case and different parts you can observe. So we know that you can see the model motor. This is a model motor. You can observe it is a rotor and it is the stator. It is a electromagnetic field coil. Whenever the electricity is given to this coil, it induces a flux and it links with the rotor, and thereby the flux from the rotor and stator interaction takes place, and an EM, the torque will develops, it rotates the rotor. You can observe that this is a small model of motor. Now let us go to the mechanical features. First of all, enclosures. What do you mean by enclosures? An enclosure encloses all the live and moving parts of a machine. That means in motors we know that live parts are the current carrying conductors and moving parts are the rotors. These are all protected from any accidental, and it gives protection to the machine by preventing the harmful increase of dust, dirt, water, foreign bodies and even persons interfering with the working. This enclosure mainly it protects from deposition of dust, water particles and other foreign bodies. Let us go different types of enclosures in day-to-day life we are using for different motors. So here you see types of enclosures. The motor enclosures classified into open type enclosure, protected type enclosure, screen protected type enclosures, drip proof enclosures, totally enclosed enclosures, splash proof enclosures, pipe ventilating enclosures, flame proof enclosures and weather proof enclosures. These are the different types of enclosures. So what is the difference between the type to type? Now let us see the difference between and its functions. You can observe here, first of all, open type enclosures. In open type enclosures, the stator and rotor is exposed to the free contact of air, the rotor being supported on in bearings. Due to exposition to the surrounding air, there may be chances of deposition of dust, dirt and other moisture particles. Hence, we have to place this motor in a separate, neat and clean room. Generally, this type of the motors are large size DC generators and motors. Next, coming to other type. In this case, this is a guarded type or the protected type. In this case, some portion is protected, but a large openings at stator at both ends of the rotor and stator is exposed to the free contact. This type of the arrangement is called guarded type or protected type enclosure. And coming to third type, that is screen protected type. In this case, the motor openings are exposed to the atmosphere, but the openings are fixed with screen covers which protects accidental contacts. At the same time, it avoids entering up rats, but this screen cannot avoid the falling of dust and water particles. This type of the arrangement is called screen protected type enclosures. And come to the fourth type, that is drip proof type. In this case, the openings are provided with large overhanging cowls which protects from vertical falling solid particles and water particles, does not enter into the motors. These type of the motors generally used in very damp conditions. We can observe this type of the motors in pump houses. This type of the arrangement is called drip proof enclosure type motors. Now coming to the splash proof type enclosures. In this case, the openings are designed such that any solid particles or water particles at an angle between vertical to 100 degrees from it cannot enter into the motor. That means, for example, if you are observing, suppose the vertical part and this is the 90 degrees and the openings are designed such that at a 100 degrees from if the flash any water particles, it does not enter into the motor, such that they design the openings. So this type of the motors is called splash proof enclosure type motors. Now let us go to the another type, that is totally enclosed type motors. This motor is totally enclosed, there is no openings provided, and we know that due to the losses the motor may heat it. The heat may be evaporated to the surrounding by the in the form of hot air, or by providing the some pins fixed on the outer surface of motors. You can see this motors here provided the pins which increases the contact area of the in surface. Generally this type of the motors used in where dust atmosphere is more, and we can used in our power system, in pulverization plant, saw machines, and we can used this can be used at generally the stone crushing quarries. Let us go to the another type, that is the pipe ventilating machines. In this case the motor is totally enclosed, but only the pipes are provided on outer surface of enclosures, through which a clean air and separate neat clean air is passes from the outside. This type of motors also used in where very dust areas available. And coming to the flame proof type enclosures, these motors also totally enclosed, and the construction is such that if any explosion occurs inside the motor due to any spark, it does not ignite the gas surrounding the motor or outside of the motor, such that they designed. This type of the motors generally used in is outside is combustion gases present, and we can generally use this type of the motors in chemical power plants or chemical plants. And coming to the last type, that is the weatherproof type. This motor is totally enclosed. The enclosure designed such that it can withstand from the sun, and it is exposed to the sun and rains, and it can withstand from the snows, dust and other the dirt particles. Generally this type of the motors are used in outdoor site. We can see this type of the motors generally in agriculture pump sets. These are the different types of enclosures generally we can observe in day-to-day life. So after completion of these enclosures, let us go to the another mechanical feature, that is the bearing. So meaning of, so what do you mean by the bearing? When there is a relative motion between two machine parts, one of the device supports the other, the supporting member is called bearing. When there is a relative motion between the two surfaces in the machine, to reduce the friction between the surfaces, we can use this bearing. To reduce the friction, we can use lubrications. These bearings are generally divided into different types. You can see different types of bearings. So bearings are classified into sliding contact bearing, rolling contact bearing. In sliding contact bearing, further divided into guide bearing, journal bearing, crust bearing. The thrust bearing once again is divided into pivot bearing, collar bearing. And coming to rolling contact bearing, it is divided into ball bearing and roller bearing. So both can support the load in radial direction or axial direction. Based on is divided into radial bearing and thrust bearing. Let us see one by one. So first of all, we see the ball bearings or roller bearings. You can see figure here. Some ball or rollers generally used to reduce the friction between the two metallic surfaces. We can introduce the balls or rollers. The balls placed in between outer rays and inner rays. Generally, the outer rays and inner rays and balls are manufactured with high carbon chromium steel. And so to keep the rollers in a position, we require one separator or cage. This cage is generally manufactured with brass or other type of materials which having low coefficient of friction. And you can see here is the rollers, you can see here is the balls, and same construction. So we can use the ball bearings single row or double row. In this figure you can observe two rows, and you can observe here is one practical example of roller bearing. This roller bearing, it is a outer race and this inner race in between balls. The balls are positioned in a particular position by cage. So here this is a bore. You can use this roller bearings for in our motors. And next, another type of bearing is roller bearings. In roller bearings, you can observe instead of using the balls, they can use the rollers. Rollers are in cylindrical shape, and so this type of the bearings can be used in our motors depending upon the size of the motors. And you can observe the practical examples of femur bearings. Here is a bearing, double row bearings, and here also you can see the cross sectional view. And here is the roller bearings, it is only single row, here is the double row. These are the few examples of ball and roller bearings. Let us go to other type of bearing, that is sliding contact bearing. In sliding contact bearing, there is no need of rollers or balls. Only the two surfaces makes sliding contact. To reduce the friction between the two surfaces, a lubricating oil or other grease is used. For a fractional motors, a film of or some self-aligning porous branch bushes are used. For larger motors, the general bearings are usually used. The bearings supports the load in radial direction or in axial direction. Suppose the bearing supports the load in radial direction, then it is called the journal bearing. Suppose the bearing supports the load in axial direction, then it is called the thrust bearing. Suppose the bearing is vertical and ended bearing itself, then this type of the bearings is called the a pivot or foot step bearings. Suppose the shaft along the bearing, then this type of the bearings is called the a collar bearing. The collar bearing may be a single collar or double collar. You can see here figure. This is a collar bearing having only one collar. This is a general bearing which supports the load in radial direction. And You can see here is the shaft is vertical and indent in bearing itself. Then it is a pivot or footstep bearing. So these bearings are generally used for higher ratings, and the noise as compared to the ball bearings is very very less, but the friction is less, as the friction is somewhat more compared to the balls or roller bearings. So these are the second type of mechanical features of motors. Now let us go to the third type, that is mounting. So types of mounting, you can see the figure. So types of mounting, so mountings classified into foot mounting, ceiling mounting, wall mounting, flange or flange mounting, cradle mounting, and body turned mounting. What is the difference between the mounting to mounting? Let us see the one by one. Let us see, here is a motor. So model of motor, suppose this motor is just assumed as this is a platform. If the motor is fixed on platform, then it is called the foot mounting. Suppose this is a wall. If it is fixed to the wall in vertically, it is a shaft may be vertically up or down, then this type of the mounting is called wall mounting. Then suppose if in this sometimes we require the ceiling, then this type of the arrangement is called the ceiling mounting. And these are the, you can see the figure in clearly, see the figure here. So this is a, if you're assuming this is a motor, the motor is fixed on rails to adjustment of tension in the belt. So this type of the arrangement is called the foot mounting arrangement or foot mounting motors. Suppose the motor is fixed to the wall, its shaft may be vertically up or down, then this type of the arrangement is called wall mounting. Suppose the motor is sometimes required to fix to the ceiling, then this type of arrangement is called ceiling mounting. Then another type is the flange type mounting. In flange type mounting, you can observe, so motor and flange both itself fixed on the load. This type of the arrangement is called the flange mounting motors. Generally we can observe this type of the motors in jet pumps. And coming to the cradle mounting type, in this case the motor is fixed on cradle. By adjusting the shaft position, this type of the arrangement is called cradle mounting motors. Generally we can observe this type of the motors in loom houses. And another type of is a body turned mounting. In this case the motor is fixed in the tool of the machine, the total motor will mount. Generally this type of the motors can used in CNC meters. We know that CNC computerized numerically controlled motors. In this case the motor is rotated any part of the machine. Then let us go to the, so you can see the different types of mountings in practically in different industries. So this is a foot mounting. Here is a motor is fixed to the this arrangement with the gearing system. You can observe here also, you can observe this. These are the different types of mountings. And few more figures in mounting. So motor may be mounted this like this, and here and here. Here is a just like it is a, so just like is a flange type motors. These are the few examples of motor mountings. Let us go to the another feature of mechanical feature is noise. So what is the meaning of noise? Noise is a sort of disturbance which pollutes the atmosphere. The noise produced by a motor could be magnetic noise, windage noise, and mechanical noise. That means, so we can observe the motors. Some motors are running smoothly, some motors giving the very high noise. Some places we require the very silent. Examples, in case of hospitals, libraries, some other temples. In the places, so we have to install the motor which gives the less noise. Mainly the noise produced from the motor due to the its mechanical noise, magnetic noise and windage noise. We know that due to the present of the core, it gives a magnetic noise. Due to the openings for circulation of air, it gives a windage noise. Due to the loose fitting of nuts and bolts, it gives the mechanical noise. And mechanical noise may be used due to the worn out bearings. And noise level must be kept to the minimum in order to avoid fatigue to the workers in a workshop generally. So if you are installing the less noise motors in a workshop, so the atmosphere may be pleasant. As a result, the more production of the workshop. And transmission of noise to the other part of the building can be reduced by making motor foundation flexible. That means the noise produced by one motor, it is avoid to transmit one place to another place by providing flexible foundation. That means by using rubber pads or springs on the foundation, we can avoid the transmission of noise from one place to another place. So there will be another type of noise. You can observe this figure. If in our domestic applications, if you are using the mixie or other commutator motors while running the TV or radio, so there may be some noise in the TV or in radios, because suppose this lines is crossing over the aerials of TV or radio, it induces some EMF in the aerials. It gives a noise. Generally, this type of noise can be reduced if we are connecting a capacitor across the motor. And what are the, now we will see the conclusion. What are the main reasons for production of noise in the motor? And so how we are going to reduce this noise? So you can see the reduction of noise. So noise may be due to resonance or mechanical vibrations. This can be avoided by using the flexible foundation. That means if at the providing the rubber pads or springs at the bottom of this ear, so you can reduce the mechanical vibrations. And noise may be due to vibration of laminations. We know that to reduce the eddy current losses in the motor, the core is laminated. If any air gap presents between the laminations, it creates a magnetic noise. It can be reduced by tightening the rivet between the laminations. You can observe the stator laminations or pole laminations in case of DC. And another is noise due to the loose fitting of nuts and bolts. This can be reduced by tightening up nuts and bolts of motors. And noise due to the magnetic pulsation. So the magnetic pulsation noise can be reduced by selection of correct number of slots. And noise due to the worn out bearing. So this type of the bearings replaced by new one, we can reduce the noise. And noise due to the non-greasy bearings. This non-greasy bearings, the noise can be reduced by some oil pouring or some replacing this old grease with new grease. So these are the some reasons for production of noise and the methods for reduction of noise. So Another loss type of the transmission mechanical features is transmission of drive. The transmission of drive means the mechanical power developed by motor is available at the shaft. This power has to be transmitted to the machine or load. We know that the motor, it takes the electrical energy from the supply. It develops the mechanical power at the shaft. This mechanical energy is given to the load. This mechanical energy transferred from the shaft of the motor to load by the different methods. Here, one is a direct transmission method, another is a indirect transmission method. In direct transmission method, so motor shaft and load shaft, both are coupled with solid or flexible coupling. The flexible coupling helps protection of motor from jerks, and it is 100% efficient, and less space is required for this transmission of power. One condition here, the load speed and motor speed should be same. So this type of the arrangement is called the direct transmission method motors. So you can see this let us assume this motor generator, both are coupled, and this coupling also enclosed by enclosures. Let us go to the another type, that is the indirect transmission. In this case, the power is transmitted from the motor shaft to load by different medias. Based on the medias is classified into belt drives, rope drives, chain drives and gate drives. Let us say belt drives. In belt drives, if you are assuming, suppose here is a motor, the shaft pulley having diameter small d, and this is the load pulley diameter having diameter capital D. I want to transmit the power from motor pulley to load pulley. So I connected the one belt, and here the speed of the motor as well as load is same direction, you can observe. Here the length, here is some conditions. The diameter of this load pulley should be less than 6 times of diameter of some motor pulley, and the space between the two pulleys should be greater than 4.5 times of diameter of larger pulley, and there is a slip between this pulley and the belt is, and the slip may be 3 to 4%, and sometimes we require the rotation of motor pulley and load pulley is the opposite direction. At that time we can connect the belt in cross belt. This type of the arrangement is called the cross belt arrangement. In this case, the length between the two pulleys should be greater than 20 b, where b is the width of this belt, but the speed should be less than 15 meters per second. Generally, this type of the belt arrangement, we can transmit the power from 200 to 300 hp. Generally, these materials are strong in tension, and it has to good frictional surface and light in weight. So the belt materials generally leather belt, rubber belt, nylon belt, sometimes camel's hair belt may be used. And coming to another type of drive is the rope drive. In rope drive, here you can see the belt drive. So here is a practical example of belt. It is coupled from the motor to load. For friction, it increases some grooves to grip the rotor pulley to belt. And let us go to another type, that is a rope drive. In rope drives, we can use two types of ropes. One is a fiber rope, another is a wire ropes. So fiber ropes can be used up to a distance of 60 meters. So we can transmit the high power up to a distance of 60 meters. High mechanical strength, low cost. Generally, these materials having property soft, smooth and flexible. Generally, the materials are cotton, hemp and manila are generally used for preparation of these fiber ropes. In case of wire ropes, so can be used up to a 150 meters long. So comparing to the fiber ropes, so we can use transmit the power for the longer distance. And silent in operation at high working speeds. At high speeds also, it gives a noiseless operation. So motor reliable, less danger for damage due to the jerks. And it can transmit the power 1100 to 2500 newtons per mm square. Generally, this type of the wire ropes are used cranes, tramways, suspension bridges. So generally the materials are used lightweight, wrought iron, cast steel and alloy steel, pore steel are generally used. And another type is the chain drive, capable of transmitting more power. It is noiseless, slipless, compact and efficient. Though it is costly, it is capable of transmitting power is more. Now coming to the gear drives, it is used when high speed motor has to run at low speed, and the speed ratio may be 6 to 1, and it has high efficiency and reliability. It operates at a speed of 20 meters per second, a transmitting power of the fraction of kilowatts to 10,000 kilowatts. These are some features of indirect transmission powers. Let us go to the these are the mechanical features of motors. In mechanical features, we have seen one is types of enclosures, types of bearings, types of mountings, noise and transmission of power. By knowing these mechanical features and by knowing the electrical features, so we can apply the select the motor for our particular purposes. We know that the motors are generally AC motors and DC motors. In DC motors, DC series motors, DC shunt motors, DC compound motors. In compound motors, cumulative compound motors and differentially compound motors. In case of AC motors, we can observe these three-phase slip ring induction motors, three-phase squirrel cage induction motors, and synchronous motors, repulsion motors, commutator motors, and universal motors. So these motors we can use day-to-day life. So here are some motors. So we can see what are the applications in day-to-day life. Here see the series motor in case of that DC. First of all, you see the series motor. So you know the series connections. If you are observing the electrical characteristics, current versus the speed, current versus torque. So it's a characteristic. And you can see the mechanical characteristic. From this characteristic, we know that it has a high starting torque, and the starting torque is proportional to the square of the current. And the speed is proportional to the load, that means it is self load controlled, and the speed can be controlled by diverting resistance. So these motors are generally used where high starting is required. Some applications you can see. So this type of the series motors can be used in electro locomotives. In electro locomotives, we can use this type of the series motor. You can see the very big size. We can use these motors for lifts and cranes to lift the some heavy loads. And coming to the second type, that is the DC shunt motor. You can see the arrangement of the shunt field and armature. You can see the electrical characteristics. You can see the mechanical characteristics. From these characteristics, we conclude that so its speed almost from the no load speed to the full load speed is constant, and speed can be controlled by two methods. So already we done in experiments in second year, that is the speed control by armature control method and field control method. Where speed is required more than the normal speed, we can apply the field control method. The speed below the rated speed, we can apply the armature control method. And the starting torque varies from 1.5 to 2 times of full load torque. Some few applications of these DC shunt motors. You can see these motors can be used in lathe machines. We can use in grinding machines. We can use in woodworking. We can use paper mills or printing machines where we require the constant speed. And another DC motor is the compound motors. You see the it has a series field and shunt fields. We can get the different characteristics. You can observe the electrical characteristics and mechanical characteristics. From that we can know that it is a variable sport, the variable speed, and it has a high starting torque. So it has a number of applications in day-to-day life. You can see the some applications. So it can be used for the planning machine, and it can be used for the punching machine. It can be used for the hoists, we can be used for the cranes, we can use for the lifts and printing machines and paper mills. So these are the DC applications. And coming to the AC motors, that is a three-phase squirrel cage induction motors. You can see the figure at a glance. This is a induction motors and this is a rotor. You can see the characteristics. It is a simple and robust, the almost constant speed, but the starting torque is less. So we can use it in day-to-day life. The applications are the induction motors. We can use the quarries, we can use the floor mills, we can use the woodworking, we can use the different type of pumps. Let us go to the next type, is the slip ring induction motors. You can see the here slip ring induction motors is characteristics. We learn that by inserting the some external resistance into the rotor circuit, the starting torque may be very high, and the large overload capacity, the speed can be varied up to 50% of its full load speed. And these applications are where require the high starting torque, that is the lifts and the hoists. And we can use the reciprocating pumps and punching presses and shears, printing belt and conveyors. And another is the synchronous motors. So we can use it where constant speed is required. We can use the, you can see the, this is the different types of alternators generally used. It can work as a motors and generators. And so another type is the universal motor. You can see the universal motor is high starting torque and it wide range of speed can be used. This can be used in day-to-day life, that is so in domestic applications like the mixes, small fans can be used in computers and in floor mills, sewing machines and hair dryers. In this class we shall discuss, so in this class we discussed about some mechanical features of motors. And by knowing the mechanical features like the types of enclosures, bearings, mountings, noise and transmission of power, and we applied these applications to the different motors and used and different application of motors for the different motors for particular services. So you can observe these all motors in our laboratory.